My name is Clancy Imslin. I'm an alcoholic. And I'm very glad to be in Toronto. I thought after I did that retreat a couple years ago that I'd never come back here. But I guess they've all died off. We are gathered today, I guess. I want to incidentally thank Marie for inviting me up here. If I hadn't had the opportunity to come up here today, I would have been forced to sit and watch UCLA and USC play football to see who's going to go to the Rose Bowl, and I certainly wouldn't have liked that. With my deep-seated guilt, I can't accept any comfort. But I think this is a subject that has recently, over the past few years, caught my attention very much, and I'm sure it has caught yours. I know that when we have a group like this, it is unfortunate that the people who need to hear what we have to say today are not here. As the old saying goes, we are talking to the converted. We are preaching to the choir. And the sinners are out there screwing around somewhere. So what we have to do is get out there and disseminate the knowledge. But it's a very, very important topic. I don't suppose there's anything that's more important today in AA than this subject. I don't know of anything. There's no saying, and certainly true. AA is... People are always worrying about the existence of AA. AA is impervious. The more we are, of course, we're not attacked anymore except by deviationists who are trying to make money off alcoholic reform or alcoholic treatments. But we are impervious to outside criticisms, critiques. We just keep our own way. But like most organizations of our type, we are indeed vulnerable to problems from within, problems that are caused by people either out of boredom or ennui or lack of information who try to change the thrust of what has made this one of only two successful treatments of alcoholism in the history of the world. You know, incidentally, I want to say one more thing before I start also. And that is that this morning I came in, I had a good night's sleep last night, but I was detached and displaced again. I had a hard week, and I flew much of the day yesterday, and there's a lot of problems on the airlines with American Airlines being on strike, so all the other planes are jammed, and the airports are screwed up, and I wasn't really at the top of my game. But it was the funny thing about AA, I was sitting this morning, and during the course of that meeting, I loosened up, and I feel just perfect now. I just feel excellent. And I want to thank the people who spoke and participated at that meeting, because I thought they all did a good job and they reminded me and centered me again, which is, of course, the purpose of Alcoholics Anonymous. But most of us know, in all the history, over 4,000 years now, in which they've had written records of alcoholism, they didn't call it alcoholism, but written records of people who seem to be among the small percentage of people in every generation who have an unnatural reaction to alcohol and who have problems with alcohol and seem to act funny. And in over 4,000 years of this now, from pre-Egyptian days, they have been working in one form or another and dealing with it, sometimes putting the people to death, sometimes sending them away, sometimes keeping them chained, sometimes sending them different places. One of the interesting things is that in the 1600s, one of the outlets for many of the alcoholic youth of wealthy families in England, they sent them to America. They sent them, there was one little colony in Georgia. And you can notice that because even today, Atlanta keeps losing to Toronto. They've never won anything down there. You know they're alcoholics. But Australia is made up of many, some of transported alcoholics and criminals and bad people. And all these years, there have been people making efforts to help alcoholics. And in all these years, there's only been two periods of time when there were significant numbers of alcoholics sober. And of course, even the newest one here knows what one of them is because you're sitting in the midst of it. And the other one is, we know about, most of us know about, the group called the Washingtonians, which started, oddly enough, in the early 1800s, and nobody knows why, the first half of the 1800s was the greatest amount of alcohol drunk per capita in American history. Nobody knows why. I don't know how it was in Canada, probably the same thing. Nobody knows why. It just was the most amount of alcohol drunk per capita. And a lot of people had drinking problems. And in 1840, six guys sitting around a bar in Baltimore, Maryland, decided that they wanted to do something about their drinking. And they'd all been in temperance movements, and they'd taken pledges, and it didn't do any good. So they thought they'd try to maybe, they'd form a little society, and make one of them president. It started off as a joke, kind of, and there'd be somebody else would be recording secretary, and somebody else would be vice president, somebody else would be treasurer. And there were two members who just were members. We all identify with those two, I'm sure of that. But they decided to have a little society where they'd try to help each other to keep from drinking. And they had to drew up a little set of bylaws, and they met every week in this bar. So after a few weeks, you know, they were talking some of the other guys into joining them, and the bartender said, get out of here. You know, we're not going to give you room to take our business. Get out of here. So they formed this little organization, and it just took off like wildfire, little by little, because there had been nothing like it before. There had always been temperance movements, but not, as they called them, reformed drunks or reformed drinkers, tosspots, as they called them, staying sober. So they, pretty soon they had a little chapter, another little chapter in Baltimore. Pretty soon they had another little chapter in Baltimore. Pretty soon they had a little chapter in Philadelphia. Pretty soon they had a little chapter in New York. Pretty soon they had a little chapter in Washington. Pretty soon they had a little chapter in Boston, which was quite a ways away, but which became the most active place for the Washingtonians for some reason. And little by little they spread all over. By April of 1841 they had a number of groups all over. They didn't have any records, but they had a number of groups around. Then they decided to take the anniversary of Washington's birthday, February 22nd, and make that their anniversary, although it really was April. So by the second year, the end of the second year, they were in most of the states, nearly all of the states, and all of the chapters had little special celebrations on February 22nd, 1842, to celebrate this event. And they'd have local dignitaries in each town come in and say a few words. And it's kind of an interesting thing because in Springfield, Illinois, they had a dignitary there who wasn't very well known, but they had him come in, a guy named Abraham Lincoln, who talked to the Washingtonians. Now, I have a book of speeches home, of Lincoln's speeches. One of his speeches is a book given to the Washingtonian movement, February 22nd, 1842. And he was not a drinker, but it's an interesting thing because he had a very unusual understanding, because he had, you know, nobody knew anything about drinking in those days, but he said, in some way, he said, it's as though your thirst is different than mine. I can't take credit for not drinking too much because I don't seem to have the thirst you have. You have a different thirst than I have. I knew if I had that thirst, I would be like you. And since you are controlling your thirst, you are brilliant and fine people. But we don't consider ourselves above you because we don't have the thirst, which was very unusual. And it continued to flourish and progress. And eventually the big temperance movements of the day took interest in it. And they joined the Washingtonians too, little by little, even though they weren't reformed drinkers. But by 1845... the bottom estimate for the Washingtonians, I mean the most conservative estimate of reformed drinkers in the Washingtonians, was 100,000. They had 100,000 members. Some people thought it was as much as 500,000, but say 100,000, which doesn't sound like a terribly large amount of people, except when you stop to think in 1940, 5 years of AA, they didn't have 1,000 reformed or sober alcoholics. And here were 100,000 and just growing and just nothing like it. And they had evolved a structure in a sense like Alcoholics Anonymous, in the sense that when one person wanted to stop drinking, they would send someone who had stopped drinking and talk to him. Some little differences, they'd have him sign a pledge saying they were going to go to the Washingtonian movement. But as one talked to another, they had people from this group go and talk to this group, and from this state talk to that state. And it really developed into a remarkably successful thing. And by 1845, they were at a point in that general area where they began to do something that seems intellectually correct, and it seems intellectually correct today in Alcoholics Anonymous. It seems right intellectually, and that is this. If we can help drinkers with this program, we should be able to help a lot more people. We should help everyone who is troubled and needs help. And some of the chapters began to work with narcotics addicts, people who were not drinkers but were narcotics addicts. They didn't take heroin and cocaine then. They took things like laudanum and opium, but they were cocaine addicts. They diversified their message. They got caught up in the temperance movement, which was always a big ongoing movement, but now the temperance movement tried to absorb the Washingtonians and pretty much did. And they got involved in, many of them got involved in stamping out alcohol everywhere. Even though I'm sober and I don't drink, now it's obvious nobody should drink. And they got involved in a lot of things. And it was a beautiful and touching advance for humankind, except for one small thing. By 1848, to all intents and purposes, the Washingtonians were extinct. There were no more Washingtonians. They had a Washingtonian hospital, a couple of Washingtonian hospitals, but they were no longer run by Washingtonian members. They were run by temperance members. The temperance movement swallowed it, and the ones that the temperance movement didn't swallow disappeared. I have a book home written by a man in the early 1860s who talks about this, and he talks a little bit about how he doesn't know what happened. We were doing so well, and we had so many people, then we got all involved in all these things, and we should be doing better, now they're all gone. Don't understand why. So to all intents and purposes, they became extinct because of internal changes. Now, how extinct they became is this. In the early 1940s, as we all know, Alcoholics Anonymous was in its formative stages, pretty much, 6, 7, 8 years sober, and starting to come across some very, very difficult times. And as very difficult times, they were pulling in different directions, they were doing different things, there were fights, there were problems, you know. It's hard to remember sometimes. When you look at early AA, it's like looking at early Christianity. You just know they're so dedicated, they're all pulling together. But they weren't. They were pulling in different directions. Because AA has the basic flaw, has always had the basic flaw that we don't know how to get away from. And that is this. It is made up of alcoholics. And we all know from gazing deep within ourselves, they're a sorry bunch. But there's a lot of problems, and we forget how sincere, you know, some of us know the old history of AA, it's no big deal, but such things as Bill Wilson's right-hand man, a guy named Hank P. from New York, was a close friend of Bill, his number one man in New York, and he provided space for Bill to write the book and did a lot of things, and he had a personal, very severe personal problem with Bill over somebody, and so he got drunk. And he spent the next 2 or 3 years traveling around to all the AA groups he could find, telling them to stay away from Bill Wilson, because Bill Wilson was a cheat and a liar and a thief. Now this was going on all, you know, it's hard enough to believe without having somebody drop by your group and say, your new leader there is a cheat. Stay away. Sounds almost like an inner group. But a lot of people were having problems with that. And there were, you know, people seeing things differently and people running things differently. And we all read about these rules that somebody put up, 61 rules in one place. And in Florida, this guy was selling memberships in AA. And they wrote him letters and said, how dare you sell memberships? He said, I'm not doing, and he had a good reason for it. I'm not doing it because it's, I'm trying to get that money, but I've discovered in Florida, at least, people around here, if you give it to them free, they won't listen. But if they pay for it, they'll listen. So I take their money and I send it to New York. I'm not trying to collect money. And there were all sorts of funny things. And A was really pulling apart. The people in New York, of course, were very resentful towards the people in Akron because they thought they were just too Oxford movement here, just the four absolutes and all that crap. And the people in Akron thought the people in New York were a bunch of hive binders from the big city screwing up everything, had no spiritual knowledge. And just everything going to hell. People in Chicago would not correspond with New York. They'd only correspond with Akron because New York was bad. And people in Los Angeles wouldn't correspond with Akron, would only correspond with New York. It's just a... In the early 1940s, somebody wrote Bill Wilson a letter. Said, we're starting to take on the form of the Washingtonians. We're pulling apart. And to tell you how extinct the Washingtonians were, Bill Wilson had never heard of them. The most successful treatment of alcoholism in history. He'd never heard of him, nor did anybody else. He asked people around him. He didn't know. He finally got some books, found out about it. And he got reading about the Washingtonians and watching their extinction. And it began to little by little dawn on him, we truly are following this path. What can we do about it? And what he did, he answered a lot of letters from, he was always answering letters from troubled people writing in. And in our town, this is going on. In our town, we don't believe in this. In our town, people are doing it differently. And he tried to, and just much trouble. And he realized something had to be done. And over a period of time, he evolved what he thought might be a solution. And in the mid-1940s, he wrote the 12 Traditions, based on the Washingtonian experience and the AA experience up to that time. You know, still amazing how many people think the traditions all came out with the steps and everybody else came out together. The traditions came out based on thousands of people dying from doing it wrongly long after the steps were written and published. And he did what he thought he should do. He published them one by one in the grapevine in the late 1940s. And as you might expect, Alcoholics Anonymous, made up of alcoholics, took great umbrage with these. Many people were very resentful, wrote letters, denounced Bill Wilson. You know, we didn't come here to get rules. We came here to find love. And if you don't accept it, I'll kill you, you son of a bitch. You know, normal alcoholic understanding. And there was a great deal of resistance to alcohol, to the 12 traditions. A lot of resistance. People didn't want to hear about this. And they could not get them together. And it's an interesting thing. AA was so pulling apart by this time that Dr. Bob and Bill, who were close, even though their followers were at odds, determined that they would they'd have to do something. So they decided if we could only have one big get-together where everybody would come to, then we maybe could get people to realize we're not so much different. And they decided to have a national, which became an international convention in 1950. But they almost didn't have it. Because first they suggested Akron as the place to have it. And the people in New York said, no dice. I guess they would rather die than go to Akron. So they decided to have it in New York tentatively. And the people in Akron said, we're not going to New York. And the people in Chicago said, we're not going to go to New York. We got some pride. So Bill and Dr. Bob got together and made a Solomon-like decision. We'll go to Cleveland. Okay. As long as we don't have to go to Akron. And in 1950, they held this first international convention in Cleveland, Ohio. That was an interesting convention. Most of us remember that convention as the time when Dr. Bob gave his last talk. He was dying of cancer. They had to help him to the podium, and he really, as was mentioned this morning, described what AA was. He first of all said that, you know, we all leave the scientific aspects to scientists who are interested, because he said in the bottom analysis, Alcoholics Anonymous is just what it says it is. It is love and service. That's all. We all know what love is. We all know what service is. You don't have to define it. It's just there. And he said none of us would be here if someone ahead of us hadn't stopped to give us a pat on the back. So we should never be too busy to give the man behind us a pat on the back. And he also said that other great line, which we all need to hear constantly. He said, let us be aware of that erring member, the tongue, and let us use it with love and kindness, and which all of us need to remember every day of our lives. Incidentally, it's an interesting thing, because it always helps me remember how human Alcoholics Anonymous is. In 1970, I was at the International Convention in Miami Beach, and I was pleased. I'd been asked to talk there at noon on July 4th, and it was exciting because the first speaker that morning was by coincidence, the guy who had taken me to my first meeting in Eau Claire, Wisconsin in 1949, and the last speaker that night was my current sponsor, Chuck C., and I was the noon speaker, and it's just wonderful. And the evening speaker Friday night was Bill Wilson. He always spoke on Friday nights at the conventions he did here in Toronto at the Maple Leaf meeting. And I heard him at Long Beach in 1960. And we were all excited, and there were about 15,000 of us in the Miami Beach Convention Center. And somebody came on and said, I'm sorry, Bill Wilson is too ill to talk. He's got emphysema, and we knew he was dying then. He said, he'll be too ill to talk. I'll tell you, you just heard 15,000 people say, oh. He said, but we do have a substitute. And they brought out some poor boob. Hi, I'm Jim. We greeted him with love and maturity. You won't get me to clap, you some bitch. You know. And after the meeting that night, we were walking back to the hotel. I was walking with an old guy from Pittsburgh named John McHugh, who was an old-timer. He got sober under Dr. Bob many years before that, 1940s or 50s. I said, well, isn't that sad? We'll never hear Bill Wilson talk again. He said, Bill Wilson will talk at this convention. I said, no, he won't. He's too sick. He said, he will. You just mark my words. So there will maybe Saturday night he'll talk. We go to this big meeting. No Bill Wilson. Sunday morning, the last chance, and they introduced another speaker, and we all felt sad. And halfway through his talk, somebody came out on the stage and tugged the guy. Got some wonderful news for you. They've just brought Bill Wilson by ambulance. He's outside the door in a wheelchair. They'll bring him in and talk. And they wheeled him in, and he stood up, and we were just all tears in our eyes. We clapped and played music, and he got up, and he said a little talk to the effect that we will continue to flourish as long as God wants us to flourish, and it's our job to see. And very touching. Then all of a sudden he ran out of breath. He'd been, you know, out of and his voice got very weak. They talked like this, and he sat down, and they whipped him out and back in the ambulance, and he died not too long afterwards. But we were going back to the hotel that day, and I said to John McHugh, I said, how in the world did you know he was going to talk? Nobody knew he was going to talk. Kid, you're dealing with human beings. Do you think Bill Wilson would want to said that Dr. Bob talked while he was dying, and he wouldn't? Yeah. I thought about that this morning when a gentleman said he saw Bill Wilson's gravestone and had nothing about the founding of Alcoholics Anonymous on it. It wasn't always designed that way. At one time, it was preliminary designed to be a mausoleum. But then Dr. Bob died, and he had nothing on his gravestone about the founding of AA. So that took care of that. Because what's amazing is that these people like you and I were able to do such a remarkable thing. But anyway, at that convention, as I started to say before I got distracted, they introduced the 12 traditions. I have the tapes home of that convention. They're kind of scratchy, but they're good. Guys getting up one by one, taking the 12 traditions and reading them and trying to explain what they meant so the people would not feel threatened. It's hard to remember today that what a threatening thing the traditions were. And this went on for a couple of days. One man would take one tradition, and another man would take another tradition, and on and on. And they finally convinced the assembled group that it was not threatening. And of course, we had no enforcement anyway. That always was a good thing. It seemed it wasn't threatening. It's kind of sad sometimes today, and you think it'd be nice if we had some enforcement, but there's nothing you can do. It's the same philosophies with sponsorship. You know, as I've often said, I've been accused in my area of being a dictator sponsor many times. And but I try to explain to people, it's impossible to be a dictator sponsor unless you have the absolute cooperation of the dictatee. Because all he ever has to say is screw you, and you're done. Your sponsorship is over. I've always felt it would be nice if we had some enforcement where people could come in the night and say, "Did you say screw you to your sponsor?" You know. Or, when all else fails, "Did you violate our traditions? Come with us to the re-education camp." But traditions are broken all the time. But anyway, they accepted them, and they voted them in. In the long form, some of you, I'm sure nearly everyone in this room has read the long form, but they, to me, are the most, that's the vital part of the traditions. In my home group in Los Angeles, which some 1,100 people every Wednesday night, but we read the long form of the traditions one Wednesday a month, because that's something that I would suggest every group do that. Read the long form of the traditions once a month, because there's, you got to keep forgetting, we all know about it, but there's a continual flow of people who never heard of it, and they never understand what the hell it's all about. The traditions get to be just something you have some newcomer read to see if they can pronounce autonomous, you know, and have a good laugh if they can't. But it's really quite important. It's really quite important, these traditions, and they become very, very valuable. They wrote the, no, not read them now. Wait till after the meeting. Well, I got to make myself more clear, apparently. But they accepted them, as most of us know. They then, for the purposes of our use, they kind of condensed them and made the short form as a kind of, in fact, if you read in the back of the book, there's the short form and the original form. And in the original short form of the traditions, as most of us know, the third tradition was the only one that was ever changed from its original acceptance and printing. It was originally accepted as the only requirement for membership is an honest desire to stop drinking. And after they got that out for a while, they began to mull it, and they began to realize that is the feeling you get after you're here a while. The requirement for membership is some kind of a desire to stop drinking. You know, just to get that bitch off my back. Just something. There's no honest desire necessary. So they finally realized that an honest desire to stop drinking was a little bit more than we could expect from a newcomer. So they voted carefully and deleted the word honest. So now, as we all have known, says the only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. And so the 12 traditions became part of our ethos, or our ethic, and they have been ever since, and they continue to be. And they are the area that, as has been said this morning, keeps us together, keeps us hanging together, or keeps us from hanging emotionally separately. And they are the things that are continually under attack from people, many of them well-intentioned, people of them coming into AA now, and using the same intellectual approach, in a sense. Wouldn't it be nice if we took everybody in? Wouldn't it be nice if we used some of our forces, purposes to serve the forces of good in other areas? Because that would seem right to the Washingtonians, seems right to generations of AA members. And it always seems so short-sighted and so old fogey-ish to say, no, we just deal with alcoholics. They say, no, you hear these people now say that it's all one disease. Narcotics, alcohol, overeating, gambling. I'm going to tell you where that concept came from. Probably nobody else in Canada will learn this today, but you're going to learn it. And you're very fortunate. The concept that it's all one disease was started by a treatment center that only has one van. Send them all to AA. A lot of people wouldn't have known that, but you know. So we deal with the concept of the traditions, and they've been gone through to some degree this morning, but they are the gel that holds us together, and they are the things most easily dispensed with by most people. And it's a continuing problem. It's a problem all over the world in AA. It is not as bad in Los Angeles as it used to be, because it so often happens. Trends start there, and they move east little by little. Styles, fashions, movements. A couple years ago, all you heard about in Los Angeles was your inner child and your dysfunctional family. You don't hear that much anymore. Most of those people have fallen by the wayside, which is what happens. And that's what one of the things that I think in passing you and I must remember is that as people get away from what the AA talks about, if they are alcoholics of our type, they will not survive. So all you have to do is outlast them. And make sure that people you sponsor are doing the things that AA says, and the people you can influence, because that's still what it's about. Because it gets down to the basic problem, that we must have a singleness of purpose. So then the question comes up, why do we have to have a singleness of purpose? What's the big deal? Maybe that's not caused the Washingtons any problems at all. Maybe it's the temperance movement. What the hell's what's the purpose of a singleness of purpose? And then we have to get back to understand that, and to explain it, we must get back to the basic tenet of what alcoholism is and why AA works. Now, it's more than coincidence, and I think anyone would agree with that, that the only two effective therapeutics for the treatment of alcoholics in the history of the world have been the only two in which they are composed of one alcoholic talking to another alcoholic. So what's the big deal about this? And it gets down to this, I think most of us would agree. If there's any single emotion that most of us have, I would say all of us, if I were not forced to be a little more tolerant, but I would say all alcoholics of my type, and I presume your type, have in common. We all have the secret knowledge, have had it, and keep it in reserve when it's needed, that my case truly is different. For very good reasons, but it's different than their reasons. I would say that's the universal feeling of alcoholics. I think when I was up at that retreat, I might have mentioned that, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, I was over in Berlin, just a couple months after the wall came down, and people going in and out of that wall, and I was at a meeting, I had a talk at a meeting, but the night before I went to a little meeting, like I did here last night, and listen to people talk, and I knew that I'd hear something remarkable. It's going to be wonderful. This is Germany united, and here are people talking about freedom. And you hear them say things like, but I don't think you really understand. I'm afraid my case is different. See it under the coffee shop, Hans, you know. And you hear it everywhere. I had a couple of interesting experiences this year. This year in June, I was asked to come down and speak in the various cities of Australia. And same old crap, you know. Go to meetings, hear it. In April, I was asked to speak at the various cities of South Africa. And same old stuff. You know, it's almost discouraging. The only thing, except for the accents, you might as well stay home. You know, it's just... The only experience I had in South Africa that made me once again grateful that I followed whatever star I did. The first day I was down there, I read in the paper that they had assassinated some black leader, communist leader. And for a couple of days it fulminated, and then it broke out into revolts all over. And we were traveling around from city to city. We wound up this one weekend at the National Convention held in Durban, which is on the east coast of Natal, at the University of Natal. We came out of an Sunday afternoon meeting, and there were revolts going on, and there was a group of black men, tall, tough, mean-looking guys. And we came out to a sign that said, "White man, we will wash our feet in your blood." And to quote Maggie, I said, "Oh, shit." I wish I hadn't said that. I wish I'd said something more spiritual, but that's exactly what I said. I thought, what now? And some little black guy came out of the meeting, who'd been in the meeting, it was a mixed meeting, and he came out and he went, apparently he told him we were in AA. She said, "Oh, okay." They rolled up their sign and away they went. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Bob and Bill. Sure appreciate it. And you too, Sister Ignatia, wherever you are. But the point of all this is that all you sit in meetings all over the world and they talk about the same things, and that feeling of difference is underneath them. And that is what kills alcoholics, I believe. In my opinion, that's what kills alcoholics. Probably more than anyone in the room, I see alcoholics die on a continuing basis. And I see them die, and I see them die in front of me, people I know. And you'd think if I can go to Melbourne or Johannesburg or someplace or Berlin or London to theoretically help alcoholics, I should be able to help a guy dying in front of me. And I used to try, but I don't anymore because I realized they have let the feelings of difference go so long that they've become like encased in a transparent cocoon almost. There's just no words can get through. Now, the feeling of difference, I think the reason it causes people to die is because it makes it clear to that person, I know you mean well when you're telling me these things. And I know that you want me to do better. But you just don't understand the nature of my problem. So there's not much sense of me doing these rather inane things that you suggest, because it's a different problem. It's kind of a paradox here. If the feeling of difference says you're going to die from it, and we all have that feeling of difference at one level or another, you may think you've gotten rid of it, but just wait till the next time you're hungry and somebody hurts your feelings, or you're cross and somebody got mean to you at a meeting, and on, any one of the number of things that trigger people like us to have momentary snits, and the feeling of difference comes back. If that feeling is always there, and that makes you die, what chance have any of us got? Well, it is my opinion, I presume it's the position of AA, that we will always have the feeling of being different. But what AA does, it treats it from becoming an obsession. When it becomes an obsession, it becomes lethal, because then it freezes out whatever I don't want to hear. But we always have that feeling, and I think that's what, in a sense, changes us. I was at the meeting I was at last night. I heard a speaker talk about here locally, and I've heard the same talk many places. A guy had been sober a number of years, got became very successful, and realized he wasn't like those people anymore, and gradually wound up on his face on the street, and all the thousands of dollars success is gone and dying on the street. And you hear it a lot. Sometimes it doesn't take that long, because it gets back to, but my case truly is different. It really is. Sometimes I'm above them, sometimes I'm below them, but it's different. Now, so what AA has to do somehow is treat this feeling of difference. But how do you treat the feeling of difference when the guy can't accept what you're saying? And that, to me, is the purpose of the singleness of purpose. The one thing that, whether you can intellectually accept it or not, the experience tells us that it is absolutely correct, that every successful transaction in Alcoholics Anonymous in the early days and in the Washingtonians and even today is based on someone getting through that wall of difference somehow, to some degree, to at least get him to open up the door a little bit from the inside. Because The key is in the inside. It isn't on the outside. You can talk to a guy till you're green in the face, and he may even agree and do go to a couple of meetings. But down deep, where the old court, you know, the old corny thing says, a man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. He has to open that door a little bit from the inside. Now, how does that happen? Somehow, he must relate with me in some secret way that he thought he couldn't. And that has been the story of Alcoholics Anonymous. Dr. Bob writes, and his son talks about how he said he was going to spend 10 minutes with this guy from New York, or 20 minutes maybe, so he could, because he was in the Oxford, group too. Dr. Bob already was the spiritual leader in the Oxford group when he was sober. And have this guy from the Oxford group talk about the Oxford group. Ho hum, he'd heard it all. Give him 20 minutes, and they went in that room and they stayed there for hours and changed the course of human history. Because as he wrote later, Bill was the first person I ever talked to who seemed to understand how I feel and why I drank. That Bill D. up in that hospital in Akron, and after Dr. Bob got, they sat around together and discussed spirituality, and then finally Dr. Bob got drunk. And they realized that was not seen to be the answer. They had to do what Bill did in New York, which is try to help someone else. So then up to this hospital in New York, up in Akron, a guy named Bill, and he was a lawyer from Kentucky, a southern guy with a southern accent, and he'd taken a geographical to Akron, and it hadn't worked out, and he was married to a very strong woman who ground him. People were grinding him. And he wound up in this hospital drunk again, and his wife, as he said, I heard him talk years ago, he said, I was laying in that hospital in Akron, Ohio. My wife said, two fellas wanted to talk to me about my drinking. And I thought, oh, hell. She rather insisted. So I said, all right. And them two fellas came in and talked to me. It's the darndest thing. They never talked to me about their drinking once, about my drinking once. They talked to me about their drinking and how they felt. And I never heard anybody describe me like that. I couldn't believe it. It so impressed me, I stuck with them fellas ever since. And on and on and on. It has always been that breaking down that defense. Now, it seems like you should be able to do this if you say you have problems. You have problems. We all have problems. Why can't we all get together, whatever the problems may be, and discuss recovery? Maybe that's possible in some degree. But to an alcoholic of our type, in my opinion, my mind is so prepared to freeze out alternatives that I can shoot them down before they get there. At the convention in Seattle on this subject, and if any of you were there, I hate to use the same example, but I don't know a better way to put it. In 1960, about 61 maybe, they founded Overeaters Anonymous about four blocks from where I was staying sober at the 6300 Club in Los Angeles. And they had no success stories. They had six or seven fat old ladies sitting around a table. One of them was a member of AA and thought maybe the 12 steps would work, and she got permission to use AA. And so they'd come over to the club and get people to come over and talk to these people, because at least on this 12 steps are obsessions. They had me come over and talk. I must have been their fifth meeting about. I came over and talked in obsessions, not the recovery from. I hadn't got that far yet, but I was an authority on obsessions. And I was very skinny then. I had weighed 130 pounds. And I went over there and I gave him a wonderful talk, because I've always been glad to talk, listening to something else. But I was telling someone the other day, the only time I ever think of suicide anymore is I'm afraid that they may have all the speakers booked in the big meeting in the sky if I wait 20 more years. So I'm sorry I said that. Take that off the tape, please. But anyway, I gave a talk, and I gave a talk to myself. It was very fine, like you would at a beginner's meeting. And then I sat down, and they had a little discussion meeting. They talked about their problems. And I couldn't believe my ears. I mean, these women were goofy. This one woman talked about eating a whole cake, and then eating some more. And I thought, Jesus, you're a sick bitch is what you are. Someone over there ate 2 gallons of ice cream. Went into the bathroom, put her finger down her throat, threw it up, and came back and ate some more. And I thought, don't shake hands with me at the end of the meeting, miss. I don't know where that finger of yours has been. And I'll tell you, I was just appalled. I thought, I've tried to help these people, but these people are goofy. These are sick people. Because food did not do that for me. As intellectually as I tried to understand them, food does not have that reaction. So it's a different thing. To this day, I'm sure that there are, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of, today in America, in Canada, we have a lot of combination alcoholics and narcotics addicts. I'm sure there are. But when I hear somebody gets up and just talk about narcotics, I'm interested, but I have no identification. I have no identification. Because it didn't do that for me, nor did I use it to do it for me. Gamblers, I talked to early meetings at Gamblers Anonymous. You know, just can't believe these guys, you know. Then I, 5 years later, I got my house back and my family came back. Then I went to Vegas, had the goddamnest week you ever saw. I lost everything. And you just feel like saying, a guy like you really shouldn't gamble, you know. Yeah. I go to Vegas and play blackjack for an hour. Just do it like a man. That's all you have to do. The emotional connection is not there. And incidentally, all of these movements, Narcotics Anonymous, Overeaters Anonymous, Gamblers Anonymous, Cocaine Anonymous, were all formed by Alcoholics Anonymous members who also had this other problem and realized that people like that had to have some identification too. So they formed Narcotics Anonymous so that narcotics addicts would have other narcotics addicts to talk to. Because they've all been talked to by psychologists and ministers and loving people, as we all have. Overeaters need a place where overeaters could talk to overeaters. And gamblers, and on and on. I suppose, once upon a time I was, again, talking on this subject, and I was casting about for a way to describe it. And I talked about it, I heard myself say a phrase that later I thought, you know, usually I was later, you say, I should have said that better. But this is one of the few things I ever said that I don't believe I could ever say better, because it really is what it is. Alcoholics Anonymous is exactly as it says it was, as it was on June 10th, 1935, or November 20th in Toronto, or anywhere in between. It is one alcoholic talking to another alcoholic to help him reduce his feelings of difference, at least enough, so that he will begin to take actions he does not yet believe in. Because the whole, as we all know, the concept of Alcoholics Anonymous is taking actions. Many times we must take them before we believe in them. Many times we must take them when they don't seem to make sense. That is what the surrender is about. I believe that's what the third step is about. When we have come to believe that there may be some kind of power here that will maybe restore me to living like I'm halfway sane, then I have to surrender to that power. That's what the third step is about. It isn't, I mean, there's all sorts of noble religious ways to do it. But to me, the ultimate surrender of AA is allowing someone to superimpose actions over me that I don't believe. And I take those actions. Later on, some years, months and years later, I can turn myself over to God. But when I most need it, I got to turn it over to somebody whose arm I can grab and says, believe me, son, do this. Because that's where it is. We can all, so often we get mixed up in spirituality and religion. We think if we believe in God, we'll be whole. In that case, it wouldn't be necessary for the Catholic Church to send priests from all over the world to Detroit to get sobered up by AA members. There's a lot of clergymen. Because no matter what your job is, you're still a human being. And alcoholics are alcoholics. And if anything is taught us over the last 4,000 years, that untended alcoholism leads to intermittent drinking till you die or go insane. As Dr. Jung told that guy in 1932 at his hospital, told Roland Hazard, he said, I'm sorry I misdiagnosed your case. I see now you are an alcoholic, and I'm sorry to tell you that to the best of my knowledge, there is no effective treatment for your condition in the world today at any cost. And this was the best doctor and the best psychiatrist in the world, who had his fingers on everything. And the Roland, of course, said, God, what does this mean? He says, it means you have to either keep yourself confined voluntarily or involuntarily as long as you live, or you certainly will intermittently drink to excess till you die or go mad. And he says, is there nothing else? And he said, there is in the literature some experiences of immense emotional dislocation, they call a spiritual experience of some sort, that happens to some people, but less than one in a million, I presume. So, that's the only thing that happens to untended alcoholics. Now, what has Alcoholics Anonymous done? Over the years, it has become quite obvious that Alcoholics Anonymous and its actions, not belief in it, the world is full of people who believe in AA who can't stay sober. Some of the people who've written great articles about AA and written for the Grapevine. I wrote an article for the Grapevine in 1951 that was so touching and beautiful about the spiritual aspects of, that when somebody showed it to me in a treatment center a couple years later, I was really impressed. I believed it, and I just didn't have a chance to practice it. But the actions here do something, as we all got to remember. What do the actions here do? They make you wonderful. You know, when they wrote the book, here's an interesting thing, to get us back to the singleness of purpose. When they wrote the book, the only thing in the steps that had been changed from the first edition of the book, Alcoholics Anonymous, that big red thing, if you ever see a copy of it, read the 12th step. Because it said, having had a spiritual experience as a result of these steps, we try to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs. And after the book came out, the rank and file of AA had come to Bill and say, Bill, that's not right. We haven't had any spiritual experience. You're the only one that had a spiritual experience. And you didn't have it as a result of these steps. You had it in that hospital in New York before you got sober. How do we stay sober? How can we do this? And it finally, they had a lot of time to think about it because the book sold so slowly, thankfully, Evan. And they thought about, and I think finally one day over a period of time, Bill Wilson finally got an inkling of something that is quite clear to see now, but they had no way to measure it then. That in some way they could not identify or understand Alcoholics Anonymous, the actions, the steps, and so on, do something that nothing else has ever done in the treatment of alcoholism. It brings about an incremental spiritual experience, which we call a spiritual awakening. And it's not the way Bill Wilson got his. Boom! But it's the way we get ours. Make amends to that son of a bitch. Little by little. And one day something happens that cannot happen. A changed perception. Wonderful way to put it, as Jack was talking about this morning. A changed perception. A changed view. A deep psychological change based on actions that I don't always agree with and haven't always agreed with and understood. Now, how do I take those actions? I surrender. I surrender to a belief that no matter how it may look to me, these people really understand how I am, even though I don't always understand it or don't always believe it. I believe it at least enough that I will continue to take actions. I predicate that on a singleness of purpose. All of our traditions have many meanings and much importance, but nothing is more important to us today, I don't think, than the singleness of purpose. I think about that. Over the years, I've had three daughters who have become AA members, and they're all doing okay, I guess. Only one has really gone bad. She's become a district attorney. And she puts people like you and me in jail all the time, and I figure one day she'll straighten out and become a public defender. But now I have a granddaughter who's working at MTV in New York, who's 22, and she doesn't drink yet, but she's in a bad milieu, I'll tell you. And I don't know, she may become an alcoholic, and her children may become an alcoholic, I don't know. But I know this, one of the things that most important to me, I'm sure it is to you if you have any children or family, if any of those people get to be alcoholic, I sure as hell want the only thing that has ever worked for alcoholism to still be here in its present form. Because all these other things, these attendant movements, this, you know, the inner child movement. I don't care about the inner child movement because, I mean, I care about it, but it really isn't something we have to be concerned with. When I don't want to go to AA meetings and hear about your inner child any more than I would go to an inner child meeting and expect them to have them read the 12 traditions. They're two different things, and that's what we got to explain to people here. We're in the business of recovery. That's what Alcoholics Anonymous does. That's all we do here. We are not in the business of seeking out, as Dr. Bob said, deep scientific reasons for why we're screwed. What we must do is recover. And that recovery is predicated upon identification. And that identification is predicated on singleness of purpose. It is ironic that we have to keep reinventing the wheel every 2 years in AA, but because people keep coming in with the same perceptions we had when we first came here. I am different. If you change it a little bit, it'll be more effective. I am different for this reason. Change AA. And somehow we have to keep it the way it is. Now, I know that AA is having a lot of problems in a lot of areas. In some places, it's having terrible problems. Sometimes the AA members, as we understand, are beleaguered, almost like islands in a sea of psychobabble. But what you got to do is you keep taking care of the people you have influence over, and the people you sponsor, the people who are listening to you, and you keep yourself pure and don't sell out. Because I tell you, if they be alcoholics of our type, as I started said long an hour ago, they will be gone sooner or later. And you and I must stay, and you and I must have a germ. A's been under onslaughts before, but nothing like this. We've had attendant movements, but they didn't want to bring them into AA. I guess we have to somehow explain to them. We are interested in your opinion, but not in Alcoholics Anonymous. Alcoholics Anonymous is what it is. It is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength, and hope in order to become sober and stay sober. Not to make breakthroughs into your inner child. Not to discover why your mommy took you off the pot at 3 years old. But to live with some degree of dignity and understanding in a world where in the history of mankind, people like you and I have never been able to live. And it gets right back to that same thing this morning. I was sitting back there having my coffee and listening to these boobs get up one after another. None of them said anything I haven't heard 100 times, but the identification came back. I know, yes, they're goofs like I am, and they're doing all right, and I'm all right. I'm glad we're here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Clancy. Enjoyed that. We're going to be breaking for lunch. And it's just downstairs to the right-hand side there.
Once again, my name is Clancy Emerson, and I'm an alcoholic. And I'm not exactly totally familiar with this question and answer. They do it in some meetings. I would certainly say, however, that I can only offer, if you have questions, I can offer my opinion. And if someone else has a conflicting opinion, raise your hand. And if I feel like it, I'll call on you. If I feel threatened, I won't. Now, how do these pieces of paper get up here, Maury? Do they make them in the form of little airplanes? And they
we are not organized. Does anyone have paper?
No, nobody's got any questions. Anybody got a question they want to ask? Yes, ma'am. See, they're not intimidated by me.
Why would you be intimidated?
Yes.
enter into your relationship with your higher power, and how did you come to be?
How did I enter into a relationship with my higher power? That really isn't germane to the singleness of purpose, but I'll be glad to talk about it. The last time I was here, I did a thing on the steps at Cedar Glen, and I talked about it there. And I know some of you were there, so it'll be redundant and old, but I'll take a couple minutes anyway. I came from a very strong religious family, and I was a sinner. And I knew I was going to hell when I was young. As I've often said, you know, years ago I used to tell newcomers that I've broken all the 12 commandments. Or 10 commandments, 12. Broken those too, but I've broken all the 10 commandments, I used to say, and I needed a lot of help. And since then, of course, I've come to realize I haven't broken all the 10 commandments. I have never coveted my neighbor's manservant. But I had a lot of difficulty with the concept of a higher power or God, because it meant returning to a force that I firmly believed would mean that I would be destroyed. So the defense I had taken is that there's no God, or that it's all just nature. And I held that position as long as I could. Of course, it doesn't always work, because at 2 o'clock in the morning, sometimes you wake up and you can't fool the dark, but you can. That old guilt gets you. But anyway, this time around, to make a long story short, this time around I was having a little difficulty, and I sobered a little while again, and they start talking about this God, and I told them I didn't want to hear that God crap in meetings, and somebody reported me to my sponsor. And you try to get a sponsor who doesn't have a lot of snitches. I mean, there's no rest for you when they do. But he and I sat down, and over a long period of time, I'll synthesize it, but over a long period of time, came to believe what I'm going to tell you quickly. It synthesized in him saying to us that, I said, no, I can't. He says, what's this about God? I said, I can't return to God. I'm not going to, if that's what it requires, to hell with it. And he had to point out to me rather firmly that nothing in AA says you ever return to God. And I said, well, you return to a higher power, then I guess that really fools those idiots. And he says, no, he never says that either. You never return to anything. The only thing you ever return to in the book, it says some people return to normal living. But he said, to puke like you never had any normal living, so you have nothing to worry about. There's nothing to return to. He says you try to come to believe in something. Come to believe that a power greater than yourself will restore you to sanity. Now the question is, can you try to come to believe in something? I said, well, I can't believe in God. He said, can't you believe in God? I said, no. He said, can't you believe in AA? And I said, no. He said, you think I'm doing better than you are? I said, I guess you are. He says, congratulations, I'm your new higher power. And he became my higher power. And a lot of people scoffed and sneered at that. That was kind of funny. I go to sponsor for higher power. But to this day, I would tell you, as I tell people again and again, I would much rather see a lost newcomer believe in his sponsor that he believes in than to pretend to believe in a God you don't believe in. Because as I say, it gets to be 2 o'clock in the morning and you can't fool the dark. You can fool them at the meeting, but you can't fool the dark. So I accepted my sponsors, my higher power. And I did things for him that I wouldn't do for most people. And it didn't bother me a great deal because I knew he couldn't send me to hell. As I was saying this morning, I made that surrender without being aware of it, that surrender of turning over. And he got me to take actions that over a period of time, as AA does, little by little changed my perception of reality. So little by little, as I stayed sober a while, I got to believe in AA as my higher power. So when my sponsor got mad at AA and stayed home too long and got drunk and died, it didn't destroy me. It became quite clear. And then I kept taking actions, and over a period of time, eventually, I felt enough of something to one night say a prayer. After I'd been sober quite some time, a couple of years maybe, a year and a half, I said a prayer. And it was brought about by a guy who had got sober in Akron under Dr. Bob. And he was telling me about he was one of the first 10 guys. And he was saying how you'd lay in bed there and all the guys that were sober then would come and give you about 20 minutes of just, rah, rah, rah. There was no, here's what we think you should do. He said how he came to pray is because an old profane army sergeant came and told him about God. And he said the line he remembered was this: "You gotta find a God. No matter what you call that son of a bitch, you gotta find a God." And for some reason that struck me. And I went home that night and said a prayer. No big prayers. I still, when I said it, I thought, what if I've been wrong? What if there's your Lutheran God waiting to find out where I am? Oh, there he is now. Whop him! But I said that prayer, nothing bad ever happened as a result of it. And I said a prayer the next day, and I've been saying prayers ever since. I've come over a period of time to come to believe an entirely different perception of God. I now believe that God loves me. He loves me exactly the same amount as he loves you, and loves the Prime Minister, and loves the guy on Skid Row. I believe he loves us all the same. What AA has done for me is enabled me to take certain actions and certain tools that have put me in a position to once in a while be able to accept that love without screwing it up. When I go to work in the morning, I have a different situation than most of you will ever see. I get out of my car, and I have to step over dying men and women alcoholics to get to my office. And I go home at night, and I have to step over dying men and women alcoholics to get to my car. And I believe that God loves them exactly the same way he loves me. And God loved me when I was one of those lying on that sidewalk dying. I believe that's what AA is about, to teach us not to get God, not to make God love us, but to take advantage of God's love. The same analogy I used at that retreat was that the same way as a television antenna sending out a picture of good or serenity or love. And what AA gives me is some directions over a period of time how to run the set. I can leave it turned off my whole life and say there never was any television. Or I can hear and learn to find it. But I think it's not uncommon to come to AA and find difficulty with a higher power, because most of us are a strange mixture of down deep of Puritan and libertine, I would say. We are libertines, and yet there's a certain Puritan part of us that is appalled by it sometimes. I think when you hear enough fifth steps, you hear again and again the pattern of how people start to almost succeed, then they somehow undo their own success, almost as a little part of them says, "You don't deserve to succeed, you rotten person." So it's really, you have to change a lot of perceptions here, and you take actions. You can't spend a lot of time, and the most important thing is to remember, we are here to find a spiritual way of life, not to find a return to religion. You can go to religion. You go to church every day of your life, and it's great. Or you don't have to go to church at all. That's great. But what you must do is accept a power greater than yourself to whom you surrender here. Because I think religion and spirituality and AA have the same religion, they have the same goal, and they've done exactly the same way. Religion says, we want you over a period of time to take a series of actions that will enable you to find a spiritual way of living. Alcoholics Anonymous says, we want you to take a series of actions that over a period of time will help you find a spiritual way of living. And the main difference is religion tries to do it by negative example. Thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. And then he says, you will, you will, you will. Gives you a series of actions to take. But they're not in conflict. You can use both of them or none of them, but you can't exchange one for the other. Okay? I'd like to introduce my assistant, Igor. Thank you. I don't know why I'm never invited back anywhere. Yes, sir.
Clancy, I was wondering what your opinion was on alcoholics who share their experience about their alcohol, in addition to that, their drug use during that period as well.
Well, theoretically, I suppose. I'm an old line, old school, right wing, fascist pig AA. I'm not proud of it. But I know there's a lot of people coming to AA now with different experiences I have. So I've had to kind of go along with what AA says. And that is this. I know that there are many alcoholics, young people today, who've used drugs as well. And perhaps, I don't know, if I were young today, maybe I'd use drugs too. I was always looking to enhance something. Although I tried drugs a little when I was young, and it didn't do it. I didn't try heroin, because in our era, people who did that were just pukes. I mean, no one... Remember, Gene Krupa, the drummer, got put in prison for smoking a marijuana cigarette. You can imagine that. Now they made him chaplain, you know. But you can be president if you don't inhale. So. But I also know that that is part of their experience. If a person gets up and talks about alcohol and their use of alcohol, and incidentally that they also use drugs and some of that, that doesn't bother me. To get up and give a narcotics talk bothers me because I don't identify, that's all. As long as they're talking about drinking, and I also took some drugs and I got in trouble with drugs, I've heard that a number of times. That doesn't really bother me too badly, as long as it's an adjunct to their alcoholism. And that's what we're here for. Any more than if a guy got up and was saying, if I'm an alcoholic, someone was saying this morning, you know, it really, it's extraneous that you're an alcoholic and a narcotic addict, or an alcoholic and a homosexual and addict. I mean, when that becomes the number one thing, that I don't want to hear it, and you shouldn't be at the podium. When that becomes an adjunct, I'm an alcoholic, I've had some homosexual problems, I've had to come to grips with those, but I've done through AA. That doesn't bother me at all, as long as we're talking about living experiences. So I don't think, because someone says, I drank and drank and drank and I also used some drugs, we should jump up to the podium and pummel them. I mean, but you did, eh? We have to make sure, that's what this thing from New York says, we want to talk about alcohol. In our group, we have a thing we read at the beginning of every meeting, says, this is a meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous, and all the speakers you hear tonight will talk are alcoholics. That's what they are, and that's all you're going to hear. Anyway, I hope that helps you. Now, the question is this. Our group conscience voted to keep announcements to be pertinent to AA and no outside issues, as it should be. What about announcing about conferences, conventions, big book study groups, which are not AA? Well, there's a tradition that deals with that. Every group is autonomous. You can do whatever you want in your group, as long as it doesn't affect other groups or AA as a whole. You can announce conventions. You cannot. In Southern California, there's a lot of conventions. We only announce one, which is the Southern California Convention, which is the AA convention where the delegates are going to have the service structure. But some meetings that announce all. I think you're probably talking about Joe and Charlie book studies. I don't think we would announce that because that is a private thing. We're not against it. I know Joe and Charlie well, and a couple weeks I'm talking with them somewhere. I'm your Saturday night speaker, but I think that's a matter of group autonomy. I think that if your group doesn't want to have those announcements made, you vote you're not going to have them, that's the end of it. And if you do, you have to change the vote. But I think the whole thing is you can't vote no and then do it. I don't think it has anything to do with Alcoholics Anonymous per se in what is done in the group. Unless you're announcing that something like the sale of the Hazelden literature instead of AA literature or something like that, where you're doing something. But even that is within AA province. Everything, there's no rules here. There are no rules except your group conscience. God expresses himself through our group conscience, and sometimes he's got a lisp or a stutter, but that's the group conscience. Anybody else got another answer to that? Can't believe it if you do, but... Where did you get that good-looking coat? Well... Oh, no, I misread it. Please explain the grace of God, the metaphor of the TV reception. Well, we just did that, but I'll go into it a little bit for a couple more minutes anyway. It's no big thing. But I had to come to believe that God tried to believe me. The metaphor I thought of, and it comes back to me from time to time, is that one of the TV antenna or the TV transmitter sending out a picture of good or love or... serenity or grace or whatever you want to call it. And then for people like me, much of my life I had the set off. And then here I've learned to use dirt dials. Now on my TV set at home, I've always explained it, is there's a bunch of dials that do something. I know what they do. I have no idea how the hell they do it. Vertical hold. Who knows what a vertical hold does, you know? Who knows what a horizontal hold does? There's electrons in there doing funny things, and that's all I know. And I don't want to know about it. My son tried to explain it to me once, and I sent him to his room. I don't want to hear about it. But I know how to run the TV. And the example I use is, so we always have grandkids in our house. I don't know where they are coming from, but they're always some 2 or 3 years old. I'm in there watching football, and I go to the kitchen, get a cup of coffee, and I come back, and they've turned the knobs. There's funny blue things on their side, and I could sit there and cry, but I know what to do. I just change it. Pretty soon I'm back in, and I slap the kids and watch the TV. Then I have to go to the whip, though. I say things like, "Here, I love you more than your other grandpa." So, it's called attraction rather than promotion. But it is my opinion and my belief that in a sense, what AA has done for me. The picture has always been there. But I've been given some knowledge of the knobs that I don't believe in, don't understand how they work. But I don't have a horizontal hold. I have maybe a prayer knob instead of a horizontal hold. I don't know how a prayer knob works. I have no idea where that prayer is going. I have no proof that any prayer I ever said got out of the room as much as I said it. I've never had the heavens open up or wonderful answers come or anything. But I've discovered when I say those, when I turn that knob on a continuing basis over a period of time, the picture gets clearer, that's all. The picture gets clearer. The color gets a little better. Take the time to listen to some dreary little puke whine that you don't want to listen to. And then the guy on the bus looked at me funny, and I'm not sure she loves me. Every fiber of my being says, "Shut up! Shut up!" Nobody, you want to give them 20 cents and say, "Call somebody who gives a shit." I don't, you know. But the knob says, "Listen and say, uh-huh. Uh-huh. Oh. Here's what I think you should do. I think it's hopeless and hang yourself." You can't say that either, but you can think it. But I suppose when I do that, the picture gets clearer. Now, I don't know. I mean, you know, people say, "Well, I've done all those things, and I got cancer." Well, I don't know what that's got to do with virus of cancer. I don't know what it's got to do with age or going blind or cataracts like Jack has got. I have no idea. There's even a book written, when bad things happen to good people. That's part of some celestial plan I'm not familiar with. But I know this. When I turn the knobs, the picture gets better. I know people who have terrible problems, who feel better than people who have hardly any problems because they're turning the knobs. It's kind of an amusing thing. Some of you know I work on Skid Row in this little mission, and people come down there in their big BMWs and their Mercedes and park it around and say, "Why do I feel so bad?" And I don't know, I guess you just don't have a mission. Screw you, you know. But I don't mean that having a car makes you feel bad. But having all those things doesn't necessarily make you feel good. You have to do more than that. You have to find something within yourself. So I don't... And unfortunately, you'd think once you got the picture set, you'd be all right and live happily ever after. Except my TV set seems to be set in the bed of an emotional pickup truck. And every time I just get that baby going, there's just no end to it. Some days you just feel, "I'd rather not have a picture today than go through that crap." And I've had days like that. I just refuse to do anything right. I'd rather feel bad than think I'm dependent on that stuff all the time. But pretty soon it hurts bad enough when you're... I wish I weren't such a fallible human being. I see people in AA around me, haven't been sober anywhere as long as I have, and they've achieved heights that I can barely view. I no longer have anger or rage I love my fellow man. And I just sit there and think, God, how do you do it? When I was new, I don't really think that way because I know better, but just when I was new, I heard a guy say that, and I thought, oh man, if that's true, I'm lost. I can never be like that. So I went up afterwards, and the devil made me pretend to trip and lay a hot cup of coffee down the front of his suit. And he regained anger and rage. And he told me I was a clumsy little son of a bitch, if you can believe that. So I have come to realize that when you have your moments of wonderfulness, that's, just remember, this too shall pass away. We are human beings. No matter how hard you write, work to program, you never rise above human being. And humans have emotions. All right? Anybody else want to talk about anything? Or are you back? You get up once and go to the can and they never forget. They never forget. All right?
Speaking of Skid Row, what are the chances? I've been kind of friends with someone kind of on Skid Row. He lives on the street. He's like 60 years old. And he drinks and he's answered like 18 out of 20 questions, right? Although he doesn't really want sobriety. I don't know. He's okay sometimes. In your experience, do guys like that get sober or what?
Well, I would say that they get sober, but they hardly ever stay sober unless there's a dramatic change in their actions. I see a lot of people on Skid Row, but some of them are alcoholics, some aren't. You've got to remember, a lot of people on Skid Row aren't alcoholics. Some are narcotics addicts now. Some are just mentally deficient. Let me give you, would you like a little 5 minutes or 3 minutes on what Skid Row is? Because I think that's one of the great puzzlements of the world, Skid Row. Why don't they get better? Why we try to help them and they don't get better? Why not? I've been working with people on Skid Row. As some of you know, I left a job in Beverly Hills to temporarily run this mission until they found somebody. And now I've been there 20 years. I'm the dean of all the people of the Los Angeles Skid Row. I just kind of sit around sometimes and just think how old I am. But I've been working with people down there every day, and when I came down there, I was full of vinegar, and I was going to help people, get them off the street, get them doing things, and doing all sorts of things. And I did it. I got them jobs, got them places, and they always wind up back in Skid Row. It took me a long time to understand why that is. And I'll tell you why it is. As far as I can tell, and I've never seen anything apart from this, in every generation of humanity, there's always a few people, 2 or 3%, who become very successful and everywhere, very wealthy. I don't know if any of you ever been to college where they grade on the curve. What grading on the curve is in the college class is, no matter what the answers are, they take the top 5%, give them an A, take the next 20%, give them a B, take the next 50%, give them a C, take the next 20% and give them a D, and take the last 5%, give them an F. That's just the curve. So I was going to be that way. And it almost seems as though in the world there's a curve, call it God's curve. There's 5% maybe who become very successful in every generation, who get a lot of wealth. There's a lot of people who become in the upper middle class, in the middle class, in the lower middle class. But in every generation, there are people that you might think of as God's F's. And there always have been. And there always will be. We talk about Skid Row as some current phenomenon. There's a Skid Row outside of every city in the world, inside of every city in the world, and it's been there forever in one form or another. And it's always, there seem to be people in every generation who just cannot cope with life. Some can cope expertly and make millions. Some cannot cope at all. And some of them are that way sometimes because of drinking, sometimes because of addiction, sometimes of mental deficiency, sometimes just because they can't stand conflict. And these people wind up in places like Skid Row, or charity wards, or charity hospitals, or camps where they send people who cannot function, non-functioning people. Now, it isn't that they're dumb. Some of them are quite bright, some of them have been bright, but they got to a point where they just can't take the pressures of living. And some of them never had it. One of the great examples of this is that in the world, especially in alcoholism, you see a lot of suicides. And I see death a lot down in Skid Row. I see death from alcoholism. I see death from drug addiction. I see death from two crazy guys. One stabs the other guy in the heart because he cut him off in line. I see that guy fall in front of a bus and gets head run over. But there's one type of death you never see on Skid Row. There are never any suicides. Now, isn't that funny? You'd think that'd be a number one cause of death, living in that grime and filth. Because suicide usually is resulting from long-term pressure and conflict. And these people don't have any long-term pressure and conflict because they give into it. In other words, the suicide is caused by the battle between your inside and your outside. How you really feel against how you might have to look. And they've given up the outside. I'll tell you who commits suicide a lot. People who look like you and me. People who get up every morning, no matter how they feel, they have to suck it together. You got to go out there and take crap from people you want to kill and go home and put that crap and problems and conflicts and finances. And if you have no, most people find tools to siphon them off. But some people, it just gets to be an obsession, pretty soon they kill themselves. These people on Skid Row don't kill themselves because they just, there's no long-term conflict. They just get through today. Get through today. We talk about that in AA. Live for today. They live for today, I'll tell you. And they have become very clever and very smart. They have a certain amount of native street smarts. What street smarts is this, for example. They will say or do what you want them to in order to get what they want. I don't know anybody on Skid Row who hasn't been to AA. AA meetings, they're down there. And they'll play the game to get the sandwiches, to get the coffee, or to get a few bucks. And they're not consciously conning anybody. They're just surviving for the day. For example, two or three years ago, Los Angeles, in another one of their efforts to help the homeless, gave out everybody on Skid Row that they could find, they gave them 30 slips of paper, good for one night's lodging in a hotel, one of the number of hotels. In 3 days, nobody had any nice lodging slips, and the brokers had sacks full of them, the hustlers. And then I said to this guy, why in the hell did you, why'd you do that? You're sleeping on the street today. He said, I kept the one for that day, and I sold the rest, because it was only today. So the problem in taking people off Skid Row or finding help in Skid Row or coming to AA is this. It isn't that they have to learn how to live sober. They have to live in a world of pressure and conflict that you and I take for granted that they can't bear sometimes. It's a very, very low threshold of emotional pain, I think you'd say. Now, the thing that I work in, the Midnight Mission, is an unusual place. All of our employees, all 80 of them, are people who have been hopeless people on the street. Now, that's the thing that holds me there. It isn't feeding. We feed 1,700 meals a day, and that's all very nice, and we bed down a lot of people, and we give a lot of clothes, and we are very clean, and we're very good. But that's all very nice, but that wouldn't hold my attention for 20 years. What holds my attention is the same thing that holds my attention today, trying to get people and see if you can get them to live in the world again. And when a guy comes off the street, they have to be handled so slowly, and it has to be almost a controlled situation. We'll give them a bed and 3 meals a day, and you have a job. Here's your job. You have to keep that little wall clean twice a day. And flexible hours. Which doesn't seem like very much, but that's the start of a structure. And then he gets immersed in realizing that all the people around him, all his contemporaries, the guys that are telling him what to do, are guys who have been just where he is, who understand. It isn't some psychologist saying, you ought to straighten out your superego. It's a guy that he used to sleep with in a box 6 months ago. Much the AA way. I know how you feel, pal. It's frightening, but I made it 6 months. If they can do that, give him a little better job. and a little better job, maybe. Or is there some place he has to be at a given time, every day? And then if they hold through that, some of them can't. If they hold through that, we give them a little salary job in the mission. And little by little, the whole mission over the years is filled up with people doing jobs they can't do. And we've also have a rather distinguished alumni club out in the world of people who are out there functioning that can't, that couldn't even wipe that wall 2 years ago. But it is such a long-term controlled situation that it's very difficult to do that as a rule. And that's what makes it so difficult to bring people to AA from Skid Row and say, look, there's a better way to live. Just pick up the steps and go with them. Okay, I will. You got a couple bucks? And they're not being cynical. They're just trying to get through the day. So it's a very long-term process. Although we have, through this program, found several people, and they've gone to AA, and they've gone to AA while in the mission. I have nothing, you know, the mission where I work has nothing to do with AA. And I do not, we have people come outside, come in and put on AA meetings, and I never go near them, because I'm not there as an AA. I'm there to run that mission. And I don't want people hustling me. But I see people get day, and I see them coming to meetings, and I see them little by little staying sober and doing well. But there's also a lot of them, a lot of people who you really are wrapped up in, who one day they just disappear. They've had all the structure they can stand. And there you see them a month later laying in a gutter somewhere. Thanks for trying to help me. I just couldn't do it. You know, it's really a heartbreaking thing. But it isn't as heartbreaking as you would think, because, you know, there's an old truism. Nothing is wonderful after you're used to it. And the example I was making about that is when you're talking to some goofy newcomer and he's saying that, I really found her. This is the one this time. As soon as I saw her coming on a detox, I... And you have to try to, you know, they say things like, well, we were having lunch today and our hands met and there was a spark. And you have to decide whether to have to tell them the facts of life. We've talked about it before. It's nothing new, you know, where you have to tell them, you know, it may be, there may be the chance of 1 in 10 billion that your relationship lasts more than 2 days. It may even last forever, and you may get married and live happily ever after, for all I know. But it isn't going to stay like this, because nothing is, you know, 3 years from now, if you're married and got 2 children, you're all sober. You're going to reach for the salt, and your fingers are going to touch, and you're going to say, give me the goddamn salt. It's just part of being a human being. Nothing is really wonderful after, I mean, it can get good and rich, but it isn't wonderful. And that, the thing that saves me is nothing is horrible after you're used to it. I used to just cry when I stepped over dying men and women and think, how can I keep this up? Now I wish them well and hope I can do something for them, but I keep going. Nothing is, it's like I assume it's got to be for an undertaker or something. You know, to me, I think that'd be just hideous being an undertaker. But undertakers don't seem to bother. It's what you're used to, I guess. I have another question here. Our group has been asked to, well, Igor, you've brought me the wrong brain again. I shouldn't be so smart till I get my plane ticket paid for. Our group has been asked to pay a signer $30 a week to sign for 3 deaf alcoholics at our group, one of which belongs to our group. This amounts to $1,500 a year. Right. The group decided to do this, then at next business meeting voted against doing this as it is not financially feasible and not in our best interest. Your opinion on this, please. Is this against our traditions? No. Our group, our big group, the Pacific group, has a signer, and they sign for about 5 people in the front row. None of the other of our groups have signers because they can't afford it. I mean, if you can afford a signer, that's fine. But it really, I mean, because it's really, you don't have to worry about the traditions, because the money is not going for a picnic, it's going to carry the message of Alcoholics Anonymous. But if you can't afford it, you can't afford it. You know, you can't, we are financially responsible. And it would be nice that every group had a signer, but they don't. I would imagine it would be I don't know if there's any easy answer to that problem. Some of you may have an easier answer than the one I know. I just know this. If you're big enough to afford it, you can do it. If you can't afford it, you can't do it. And it really wouldn't even be feasible to ask one or two wealthy members to underwrite it, because that's not the way AA works. You could if you wanted to, I guess. But it gets back to that group autonomy again. It is not against the traditions to have a signer. It is not against the traditions not to have a signer. You do the best you can to carry the message. Our primary purpose is to carry the message to the alcoholic still sufferers. Some of them are deaf mutes. If we have a way to do it, we'll do it. But if you haven't got a way to do it, you can't do it. Not a very satisfactory answer, I'm sure, but that's what life is. Now we'll see what Igor has brought up. What about women's groups, lawyers' groups, special interest groups? Well, in my opinion, I'm required to say that, although I secretly feel I'm talking for Bill and Dr. Bob in heaven. The major difference of special interest groups, the reason that they are very rarely successful on a continuing basis, is the same thing we talked about earlier today. The basic problem is my case is different. And when I get together with other people just like me, we sit around and explain to one another how different we are from them. That's what's wrong with lawyers' groups, because lawyers get together and say, it's really tough to be a lawyer. And all of them say, yes, it is. It's really tough to be a pilot. It's really tough to be an actor. I know when I was kind of new, there was an actor's group in Los Angeles. Met in one of the actors' garages. Very fancy. His garage was better than most people's houses. I mean, very fancy in Beverly Hills. And it was an invitation-only meeting. And God, I did everything in my power to get invited to that meeting. I sucked around people. I just said, boom, you know, just like this. Didn't have any front teeth. Cost kind of my credibility. After about 2 years, I finally sucked around and got an invitation to this guy's house. And I went there. I looked as nice as I could. And they went around the room, and they were all famous actors. I'd seen them all in movies. You know, you can take the boy out of Wisconsin, but you can't take Wisconsin out of the boy. I try to be blasé. And they'd been having that meeting there for several years. It was quite famous. And we went around the room, and even I talked finally. And on the way home, it suddenly struck me. I had the most sobriety in the room. They all talked about the difficulties of being an actor, and those who'd had slips recently, everybody else sympathized with them. They all knew their case was different. And that's what really is the problem with special interest groups. It reinforces the feelings of difference. Alcoholics Anonymous. Now, I understand the reason for a lawyer's group, and I've talked to lawyer's groups and doctor's groups and pilot's groups, and they're great. They are enable people who come here very afraid and feeling, how will anybody understand? They go to a lawyer's group, and they're all lawyers. Oh, it isn't so bad. But after they get there, then the good groups, the good special interest groups, push them on. Yeah, you can come here one night a week if you want to. But you must go to AA meetings with everybody, because AA teaches you to live in the world with everybody, so you got to be out there with everybody. You cannot learn to live in the world with everybody sitting with clones of yourself discussing how different you are. So I think that men's group, I mean the lawyers' groups, doctors' groups, the well-run ones act as a halfway house for frightened professionals on their way to AA. The bad ones keep them here to build, say, yes, we are different, and they go down the toilet. And a lot of them go down the toilet. Now, there's the other different case is women's groups and men's groups. And there's been a continual controversy about that forever. In my opinion only, that is the only special interest group I don't have any problem with. Because I do believe, whether we like it or not, the mores of life make it possible for women to speak more openly in front of other women than they can in front of men, as a rule. Men will talk about things in a men's stag that they would never talk about in a mixed meeting. I don't mean that they have to turn into big sexual frenzies and orgasms, but there's all sorts of things that they talk, because whether we like it or not, we are human beings. And I think that I would not want to see anyone go to a steady diet of men's meetings or the same-sex meetings. I think they should go to maybe one. In our group, we have one woman and one men's stag on Friday night. And the rest of them, that's the only stag meeting we got. Because you have to get out there again, get with the homogenous world. And you go to a meeting, and there's a wealthy guy sitting there, and a poor guy there, and a truck driver there, and a skid row guy there, and that's what life is. I think, in essence, the special interest group sounds so attractive and is yet one of the most lethal things in AA because it preaches the reinforcement of feelings of difference. Men, they're fine as a halfway house. Men and women stags, I think, are fine as long as they don't become the end-all and be-all of AA, because then again, you are reinforcing difference. I'm different because I'm a woman. I'm different because I'm a man. And they all turn into victimization. Please share. This is like a Frank Sinatra concert. Now sing Melancholy Baby. Please share the story about the difference between treatment programs and AA recovery using your story of the invisible boat. Well, I don't remember that, so I told that story in Montreal at the International Convention, and the guy in the back got so crazy he ran down the aisle going to kill me. Well, he didn't get me. I'll tell you something funny. Were any of you at Montreal, any of you possibly, when that guy jumped in the back and started screaming? Yeah. I've often wondered who that crazy bastard was. You know, I'd like to have him find him and let him make amends to me. I was in Montreal about 6 months ago, and somebody comes and says, "Hey, you know that guy that jumped up and screamed at you?" And I said, "Yes." "He's doing good." Yeah. Broke my heart, I'll tell you. Well, anyway. The question for the three people here who are still awake who have not heard the story, it is it's another one of the things that I, on the kind of the spur of the moment, I was talking and I made it up as I went along. And later I thought that's one of the few things I ever made up that it was smart. You know, I can't believe it. I must have been off my decaf that day or something. But the question between treatment centers, of course, I was raised in an era where they didn't have treatment centers. Treatment centers were sanitariums and just drunk farms. And since I've been sober little by little, they've had this proliferation, especially since insurance made it possible for people to get treatment. And over the years, the old-timers, you know, we'll say, damn, treatment centers, alcohol. But I tried to be tolerant. Little by little, I realized there are good treatment facilities and there are bad. And it's an interesting thing. The treatment facilities are starting to close up now. The big chains are going bankrupt because the insurance companies are refusing to pay for the same people again and again. How cold of them. But the difference between a treatment center and AA recovery, and the one I was able to think of was this. It's like going down to the shore here of Lake Erie, Ontario, I mean, whatever lake it is, they all look the same to me. On the other side of that lake is what?
Rochester,
right. And Niagara Falls, eventually over there somewhere. I don't know where. How do I know? Anyway, if I went down to the lake here and wanted to go to Rochester, and I walk, and here's a little skiff, a nice, attractive, well, freshly painted, nice little men in white jackets, saying, "Come with us." Out of the galley is wafting smells of delicious food. We're called the SS Treatment Center. We're going soon. And down the beach a little while, there's two guys kind of skulking around the grass and saying, "You want to come with us? We're what's called AA. We got an invisible boat." "Gee, I'd like to, guys, but anybody in their right mind would go to the treatment center. And then they do exactly what they said. You get in there, away you go, good food, take care of you, teach you knowledge about your illness. Everything is fine. Just great. The only problem with them is this. They just get out of sight of land, and they say, "Well, that's as far as we go. We've got to turn back down and get two more." Well, what am I supposed to do? well, you're in good shape. Swim like a sumbitch, you know. And so you're out there in Lake Ont. And here come these two boobs by in their invisible boat. You want to ride? I'm not that sick. And you go for a while further and you can hardly... You want to ride? Okay. And they throw you in the boat. You look around, there's no boat. What is this? What am I supposed to do? Well, grab an oar and row. You're crazy. Maybe you swim really almost dead one more time. Okay, what do I do? I'm dying. Grab an oar and row. Oh, you crazy bastard. And the irony of AA is this. As you begin to row, the boat appears. But it doesn't appear until you begin to row. It's almost the most peculiar thing. And if you row long enough, especially the boat gets bigger, more solid, makes the little treatment center skiff look like nothing. Don't even want to go to Rochester. Just stay here, baby. And the irony of that is that there's another side to that dimension. When you stop rowing, the procedure reverses. Little by little, the boat disappears. Just a little, by little, by little. Do it long enough, one day you're in the water. You wonder what the hell happened. That's what sponsors are for. They come along and say things like, hey, you got your oar upside down, goof. And I suppose that's that analogy describes the different treatment centers and AA very well. And that's what differentiates a good treatment center from a bad treatment center. There are a lot of treatment centers, many of them going broke now, but who've taken the position that what you do is that you go to our treatment center, you learn enough, and you'll be able to swim it from there. And if you want to go to AA or one of those little things, if you're that weak, that's all right. If you want to get in an invisible boat, if you're... But just swim. And that's why the people have little or no success. The good treatment centers say, yes, we will take care of you, and we'll get you out of here. But as soon as we drop you off of that water, you look for those two boobs in the invisible boat and jump in and roll like hell. And those are the people who become successful, who have people who say, yes, I went to a treatment center, but they steered me to AA, and I've been living comfortably here. Or the opposed, I've been to every treatment center in the area, even gone to a couple AA meetings. I can't make it. I can't understand it. Because despite what anybody tells you, and I wish, you know, there is no other place in the world than AA where sobriety is available to alcoholics on a continuing basis anywhere. You hear about these damn therapies and all these things. These are all people, nearly all of them got sober in AA, and after they've been sober many years and still doing what AA says, telling other people they don't have to do those things. It's just hideous. But AA works, and it works good. As we said this morning, in the history of Alcoholics Anonymous, in the history of alcoholism, I should say, there have only been two therapies that work. They all deal with one alcoholic talking to another alcoholic. And they all deal with breaking down the feelings of difference. And they all are dissipated by multiplicity of purpose. So the result has got to be just what it says on the paper. Singleness of purpose. And as we again said there, to reprise what I said this morning, so I think it never could be said too much, I know that all of us have people in our groups that don't believe this. And some of us have groups where they don't want to hear it even. So the answer is always the same as it has been since the Christians were in the catacombs. You and the people who know better do it right and influence people as they come along. And the people who don't agree with you will be gone pretty soon anyway. But you maintain the kernel, the nubbin, Alcoholics Anonymous, the only thing that ever worked for people like you and me. And it'll make the life the best you've ever had it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Clancy. There will be a coffee break from now until 3:30.